TheOneTAR! Welcome back to another episode of Tiffany Teaches Painting with Mice and Mystics. If you are joining us for the first time, this is a multi-part series and there are episodes on the roaches and the spider already in production that you can go ahead and watch now. I'll wait. But this week's episode is all about the centipede. The centipede is the second largest figure, or actually maybe the largest, kind of depends on how you're going, but it is one of the larger figures, the spider being the other large figure, that is all by itself, which means that we only have one shot at this, folks. But don't panic. I have a technique that I think will be pretty easy for you to pick up, especially after the spider, and you'll find it gives you big bang for your buck in regards to final results. In this video, for painting the centipede, we're gonna go ahead and use a layering technique similar to what we used on the spider, but we're gonna do it on a much smaller scale. So on the back of the centipede figure, there are several shell plantings that are very well defined, and we're gonna paint each of those as its own little section of layering. And so there's gonna be a lot of repetition of layering and doing the same thing over and over again on each of these shells. And it's gonna take a little bit of time, but the good news is because there are so many shells, by the time you finish the final shell, the first shell will be probably dry enough for you to move on and do the next step. So this figure is gonna go really fast, but it's gonna take a little bit of time and a lot of patience in regards to how we layer this up. So let's get into this. First things first, as with the spider figure, we're gonna go ahead and paint our centipede a light brown all over. So I did a 4-to-1 paint mixture of 4 drops of light brown paint. I'm using Reaper Minis paint in this one, with 1 drop of water. If you are using a Citadels Minis paint, I would recommend dropping in an additional drop of water just to help get it a little thinner. You're not going for a complete 100% all around coverage, but you do want to make sure that you cover the entire figure, though maybe not 100% like thick, right? So it's okay if you still see some of the gray through, especially on the back crunchy shell bits of this figure. After you've gone ahead and done this first priming, almost secondary priming with this light brown color, we're gonna go ahead and do another layer of dark brown. So I used a Citadel's Minis paint for this one in a 3-to-1 ratio, so 3 drops of paint to 1 drop of water. And again, I painted the entire figure. I wanted to make sure that the middle parts of each of the shells was nicely painted. I'm not too worried about the very edges of the shells. I also wanted to make sure that the side of the figure and the underside, the soft belly part of the figure, was nice and well painted. I also made sure that the legs had a little bit of this darker brown on it, but not too much. Like, I didn't paint all the way to the tips of the legs. I let those be that light brown color that we did previously, kind of to give us a similar effect that we gave to the spider in last week's episode. Again, you want to make sure that the back shells, especially the middle part, are well covered with this brown, because we're going to be building tone off of this brown on those shell parts. Again, don't worry about getting it deep into the edges on those shell pieces. Just make sure that it's a good general coverage in the middle from side to side. All right, so you might be like, Tiffany, that was a lot of paint for you to put 3-to-1 drops of on our palette. And I go, yes, that is true, but we're gonna add to it now. So similar to how we brought the spider paint colors darker as we were layering them, we're gonna do that twofold with this figure. Each of these shells is gonna be its own little canvas that we're going to paint with lower or lighter colors on the bottom part and darker colors on the top part. And we're gonna achieve that by painting nice thin strokes across the figure from left to right for each shell piece. We're not gonna worry about having a nice even straight line at the top of our strokes. We just wanna make sure we come to a nice crisp line at the bottom of each shell piece or the top, depending on which section we're painting. So let's go ahead and get into that. The first step is you're gonna add a teeny tiny little bit of white paint to just barely lower the color or brighten the color, depending on your perspective, of that brown that we've already had previously mixed. You're gonna mix it up really nice and maybe add some water, but I actually don't thin this paint too much. I want the pigment to be sharp and crisp, unlike with the spider figure, where we wanted it to be more subtle. But I use my fine tip brush for this part and for most of the rest of the figure in painting these nice thin layering lines. Once you have your paintbrush nicely loaded, make sure you don't have too much paint and then paint nice thin lines from left to right, starting at the 40% mark to the 0 mark with this lighter color. Once again, it's not important to have a nice crisp edge at that starting 40% line. You want it to be a little uneven. Maybe some strokes are 42%, maybe some are 46%, maybe some are 38%. That's fine. You want it to be a little uneven. It's not going to be perfect. No centipede is perfect. The important thing is to make sure that the color that you're going from, which is that original brown, is only slightly different from the color we are painting now, which is just a slightly more white version of that brown. Once you've done these 40 to 0% layering on each of the shell pieces, it's time to add a little bit more white paint. You're gonna add, again, another tiny amount of white paint, and then you're gonna paint on each of the shell pieces from the 30 to the 0% marks. Again, you wanna make sure you use nice thin strokes from the left to the right of each shell piece, and don't worry so much about going over the 0% mark into the next shell piece. We're gonna cover those up in the next step when we start going darker. Oh, you finished that part. Well, my friends, it's time to add more white paint. Add another tiny bit of white paint to your brown mixture, and then go ahead and paint from the, you guessed it, 20% to 0% mark on each of these shell pieces. Again, using nice, thin strokes. All right, now, you guessed it, last bit. So this one, you wanna add a little bit more white paint. It should be getting really close to a whiter white, but you don't want actually pure white. You just want slightly more of like a tannish brown. But you're gonna paint, again, with this new, slightly lighter brown from the 10% to the 0% mark. And this one for me was just mostly doing like little dot strokes. And again, don't worry about painting over into the next shell piece. We're gonna cover that up here in a second. You just wanna make sure that you have a nice, slightly brighter strip at that 10% to 0%. This can get a little tricky where the centipede is kind of like curving to the side. Don't worry about being a perfectionist on this. If you can't get your brush in there to do the strokes that I've been talking about, go ahead and just do a little horizontal line, especially on this last part. That's totally fine. There's one piece in particular that I had a lot of trouble getting my brush into, and I decided it was more important that I get the outer edges that were more visible on this shell piece, get those painted, and not worry about the center part of that shell piece, which is really hard to see to begin with. And it's kind of obscured by the model itself, and it's in shadow, so most people aren't gonna see that you didn't paint this one slightly whiter color on that one piece. All right, now this is one thing that I look. If you look at your centipede from like a top-down perspective, you should see there's kind of this natural gradient effect that is happening on these shells, almost making it look like the centipede shells are tilted slightly, maybe overlapping somewhat. That's the effect we're going for. So for the next step of the process, we're gonna go ahead and do the darker layering on the top part of each of these shell canvases pieces. So we're gonna go ahead and mix a new batch of brown paint with 3 drops of brown with 1 drop of water. And again, I use Citadel Minis paints. If you're using Reaper Minis, you might need to do 4 drops of paint with 1 drop of water. And then you're gonna go ahead and add a very tiny bit of black paint to help bring this color down a little bit. And then we're gonna start painting the top part of the canvas. We're actually gonna start painting these around the 65%, maybe the 70% mark, up to 100. This is where you wanna make sure that you don't go over the top of the shell piece into like 110%, because then you're gonna be painting over what you've already painted with your nice white layering. You wanna make sure, and it's totally fine because we're going darker, to not paint all the way to the 100% if you're worried about going over. That's cool, we'll fix that in a little bit. So maybe you're painting from like the 65% to 95%, that's fine. Again, because we don't want perfect strokes, go ahead and paint, you know, a couple 66%, 162%, etc., etc. Once you've painted that first layer of darker brown, go ahead and add another tiny drop of black paint to your brown mixture, mix it up really well, and then go ahead and paint the next layer from about the 75 to 80% mark up to 100%. And again, don't worry about going all the way to 100%. You wanna make sure that you're not accidentally painting over any of that white area that we painted previously. If you actually do paint where you're not supposed to or don't want to paint, if you catch it quickly enough, you'll be fine. Go ahead and quickly wash your brush off as much as you can, and then while your brush is still pretty wet, you're just gonna go ahead and put the water that's on the brush on the spot that you messed up, swish it around a little bit, and then dry your brush off and to use your brush to soak up that excess water and hopefully the paint that you didn't mean to get in that location. All right, you know what's next. So now we're gonna paint again another layer. So you're going to once again add another tiny drop of black paint, and you're going to paint from the 85% to 90% range on this centipede scale technique canvas that we're using. Again, for some of the pieces that are like really flexy where the centipede is turning, you don't need to worry about being actually precise. If you can't get your brush into there, don't worry about it. It's more important that the sides of the centipede shell that are more visible to people sitting at the table are painted than like the center part, which you can't really see anyway. All right, last layer, here we go. You're gonna add a little bit more black paint, maybe a little bit more than you've been adding previously to get to an almost black shade with this brown. And then you're gonna paint that final 90, 95% to 100% mark on each of the shell pieces. If you need to do a horizontal line instead of doing dots, that's totally fine. I actually do that on some of the smaller shell pieces where that little bit of percentage is actually very thin. I just do a horizontal line and I don't really worry about it. Almost like right in that top of that crevice. If you look at your centipede from the top down, you should now see a very awesome gradient effect on each of the scale pieces, which adds a great effect that makes it look like the centipede pieces are almost overlapping. I think it's awesome. Now that you've done the really hard part of this figure, everything else is just gravy from here on out. Using this much darker brown, I went ahead and did each of the cracks on the belly of the centipede, as well as the line along the sides of the centipede, not on the shell part, but like almost under the shell, and maybe in like the centipede armpits, he's got a lot of arms, but those armpit areas. I also decided to do a little bit of the brown on some of the tops of the, like, what would be shoulders on all of the arms. I didn't do all of the arms, but I did a few of the arms that I thought it would be good to have a little darker. You could also do kind of like along the sides between the arms, which, again, armpits, I already talked about that. So that's just kind of a bonus if you want to bring more interesting depth into the figure and you feel like you have the control with this fine tip brush to do that. Nothing else, I recommend doing the stripes on the belly, for sure. All that's left now is details. So with the yellow, I recommend you do just a couple drops of yellow paint and then do features such as the eyes. I like a nice bright yellow eye. If you want a more sinister figure, you can go with a red eye if you would like. I kind of feel like the yellow brings it out a little bit more. I also did yellow on the tips of the fangs. So the fangs, I kind of had that brown on it, and then just go ahead and add a bit more yellow. You can put some of that dark brown that you probably still have on your palette on like the back part of the fangs if you want, and then have it kind of almost gradient into that yellow. Just experiment with it. See what works for you. Also, deep inside its mouth, so it's got its fangs and it's got its antennas, and then it's got like little fangy thingy sitting here. I went ahead and just very carefully with my fine tip brush painted those yellows so he looks a little happy and smiley, because nothing says happy smiley like a creepy centipede. Now it's time to wash the centipede and finish it up. So as with the spider and all the figures moving forward in this tutorial series, I use Agrax Earthshade from Citadel Minis paint, which is a pre-made wash that I absolutely love. I definitely recommend getting yourself a bottle if you haven't gotten one already. It will change your world. Otherwise, you can make your own wash using two drops of brown paint with one drop of black paint and then 3 to 4 drops of water, maybe 5 drops of water. You really want it kind of thin. Then you're just gonna go ahead and wash the entire figure. Make sure you get the center leg part, which is kind of annoying, and the backs. Make sure you get the backs. Make sure you get the mouth really good. Make sure you get the eyes. Make sure you get everywhere on this figure. The legs, you really wanna make the recesses pop with this wash. It'll get in the cracks and crevices and it'll just really bring this figure to life. One way to make sure that you're covering everything with the wash will make things shiny because it's wet. So just look to where you don't have anything shiny and then just know that you're gonna need to add wash. As always, you can move the wash around, so feel free to overwash and then use a drier brush to go back and pick up excess wash and crevices and cracks that you don't want there. And that's it. That's the centipede, right? This was a super straightforward, simple technique that really does add a lot when it comes to gradients and shading. And when it's combined with the multiple shells of the figure, it just makes it just, it's crazy. I love it how simple this figure comes together. All that's left is to paint the base. If you've been painting along with this series, you will have already picked a base color for your villains, and I would recommend you just mix up a batch of that and use that to paint the centipede. For me, I use 2 drops of Shadowstone with 1 drop of white, which are all Reaper Minis paints, so basically 2 drops of gray with 1 drop of white, and I carefully painted the base all around the figure. The outside of the base is pretty simple on this one. You can use your brush to kind of like slide along between the legs. The really tricky part of this figure and its base is, of course, the center. Those little tiny legs are a nightmare. For some of these legs, if the gap was big enough and I was comfortable, I used my fine tip brush, put a little bit of my base paint on the brush tip, and just carefully dabbed in between those little legs. But for the most part, I didn't really worry much about painting in between the legs. There's enough shadow and recess going on, and considering we were using darker browns for the wash anyway, I'm not too worried if I don't get parts of this base fully painted. The big center part in the middle of the legs, and then where the centipede like circle is open, I make sure I paint into that. But otherwise, I really don't stress about painting this base completely. No one will really notice, trust me. And that's it! We're done! We have now painted successfully a very gorgeously creepy centipede. I hope you enjoyed painting along with me, and tune in next week where we start painting the rats. I am super excited to paint the rats, and I don't know if you've noticed this, but I've been sneaking new techniques in every video to help you grow as a painter. And for me, it makes teaching you how to paint so much easier because you already know techniques and we're building off the knowledge that we've done in previous weeks, which is why I delayed the rats until next week, where we'll introduce new techniques that are very helpful for painting humanoid figures, including weapons and fur, though humanoid figures don't always have fur, but the rats have a little bit of clothing in addition to their fur, and painting fur is a lot of fun, especially if you know the layering technique like we did with the spider and the centipede. So tune in next week to watch the rats. If you're gonna paint along with us, these are the colors that you need for the rats. For the most part, you should have most of these colors already, but there are a few key colors that I'm adding to the list because they help us paint the rats' weaponry. That's right, these rats got weapons. I don't know why I made that face. I divide the rats into 2 groups where we have gray rats and brown rats, which helps them with the squatting that can happen in the game. And my gray rats, I go ahead and give them bronze or gold insignia and detail. And aside from that, that's really the only gold that's used on these rats. Some of the figures in the future, the mice figures, will have that gold on them as well. So it's up to you if you just want to get one metallic paint and go with the honed steel, or if you want to go the extra mile and anticipate buying gold for these rats and some of the mice figures in the future. If you've been painting along with this tutorial series, I would absolutely love to see your in-progress shots of your figures. Seriously, it brings me so much joy. You can reach me on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, or Gmail at TheOneTAR at all of those places. I absolutely love getting pictures of in-progress projects, especially that you've done following along this series. Also, if you've taken liberties with colors and techniques, let me know. Seriously, I am not an amazing, talented painter. I'm not a professional painter. I am just somebody who one weekend decided to paint her partner's Imperial Assault figures and got freaking hooked and wants to spread that joy to others in the industry. So please share with me your in-progress shots or different techniques that you have done with these figures. I seriously, genuinely do like seeing them. That's it for this week. This video is brought to you in part by my awesome Patreon supporters. Thank you so much. Seriously, I would not be able to make these videos without you guys. Every dollar does help. If you do enjoy these videos and you have a dollar to spare every video, maybe go on over and check it out. You can set monthly limits, so you can just give me $1 a month or $4 a month or something like that. That's totally cool. Seriously, no sweat otherwise if you can't.